Namaste, viewers. My guest today is Dr. Anil Kakodkarji, who is the former chair of the Atomic Energy Commission of India, a very distinguished person who's won the Padam Shri, the Padam Bhushan, and the Padam Vibhushan, all three important awards, and a long list of other recognition and awards, both in India and internationally. A truly great scholar, scientist, intellectual, and a policymaker for the Indian government. Dr. Kakodkarji, I am honored to have you here. Thank you. Namaste. I want to discuss my book on artificial intelligence and the future of power, which takes five battlegrounds and discusses them in some detail. A lot of the issues are the same as technology, whether it's space technology, whether it's nuclear technology. The issues of policy and social impact are the same. For example, I want to share this with you and get your comments. Technology is inevitable, and it's not a question of whether we want it or not, it's going to happen. We might as well join it and do it responsibly and control it rather than letting it control us. Now, the disruptions of artificial intelligence, like most technologies, will be unequal. So some educated people will get benefit. Less educated people may lose their jobs. It has different effects on different social economic strata of society, different industries. It also creates disparities in regions. So maybe a certain high-tech regions within a country will do very well, and the less developed places will not. And then there is disparity between countries. Just like the Industrial Revolution created colonization, and Britain and France became the colonizers. Of course, they were fighting against each other also, and the rest of the world becoming colonized. Similarly, it could happen that China is creating its colonies, like Pakistan is a colony of theirs and a large part of Africa, and US is competing. US has its spheres of influence. So what do you think of this unequal, the unequal impact creates disruption? Because old equilibriums and old balances get disrupted, and there is a struggle for everybody to join this new revolution, but they have unequal ability to do so. So what are your thoughts on the social ramifications that are brought about like this?
Thank you for having me. And before I come to the specific question that you have put, let me compliment you for this wonderful work that you have done, writing this book at this stage of the game, Artificial Intelligence and Future of Power, and discussing this very important question in the context of five battlegrounds, as you said. So this is, I think, a great contribution, and I'm sure it will trigger a very important discussion, conversation in the societies. To prepare societies themselves, prepare humanity going forward. You know, we're all human beings, but we are a part of the larger animal kingdom in the nature. Now, in the larger animal kingdom, I'll not call them jungle laws, but there is some order, some rules of the game, whether one likes it or not. And they are driven by a set of factors, survival being one of them, might is right, and things of that kind. But humans are different compared to all the rest. That way, I think there is a certain level of intelligence among all animals, all living beings. But that is more to do with, you know, just ability to find food, ability for survival, and things of that kind. Whereas the intelligence which the human beings possess, and the way the brain has evolved, the human brain has evolved, it has gone quite some distance compared to any other. Of course, even in animals, there are gradations, but it has gone quite some distance compared to any. Whether it is good or bad, if you fundamentally ask, I would say I don't know.
Okay.
Because the question is, you know, the human beings, just like animal kingdom has some set of rules or something, human beings, the building of societies, and we also created a set of rules of the game at the local level, at regional level, and there are, you know, in recent times, there are also rules of the game at the global level. How much one follows, how much one violates is a matter of constant debate, which is what happens everywhere. So now the point is that are we all abiding by the rules that have been created by kind of well-meaning humans in a collaborative, cooperative way? And the answer is probably not. And so I think in all of us, there is some human being, there is also some animal. And that animal instinct does not go away. Now, of course, it is the ability to think, the intelligence, the human intelligence has brought us all these creature comforts. We have, humans have become all powerful compared to any other species. Maybe for the good of human beings, maybe, in fact, the other way of looking at it, we are almost creating a disaster for the Mother Earth. You can trace it back to the human intelligence. Now, come to era of technology advancing to the level of artificial intelligence. First of all, the animal instinct in human beings creates disparity, the point you raised. Now, technology augments the human capability. So, a human being more equipped with technology or more technology savvy, and another human being not so much savvy, that will only contribute to greater disparities.
Yes.
And similarly, I come from the area of atomic energy. And atomic energy, there are several ethics issues. On one side, weapons, other side, radiation. And people have a lot of apprehensions on atomic energy. So there are a huge number of issues related to ethics. So I often get asked this question that, and of course, I was brought up in a Gandhian family. So I have those roots. So they in fact relate that how you coming from those roots, how you got in atomic energy, is it not bad? Or how you look at it? And I often reply saying that, look, technology is never good or bad, regardless of how powerful that technology is. Technology is technology. It is the quality of human mind that dictates whether the technology is good or bad, or whether technology will be used for good purpose or a bad purpose. And so the important thing is upbringing of human beings. And that has, I think, many dimensions beyond just acquisition of knowledge. It is not related to just artificial intelligence. It is related to any other technology as well. Artificial intelligence is a more powerful technology. So you will see this phenomena in a much, much more stark manner. That's the difference.
So, you know, just to draw a comparison, India, in the case of space with ISRO and atomic energy, which is, you're one of the pioneers and leaders, with the Bhabha Atomic Research Center, decided that we must also be in the fundamental research and development. We cannot just import and manufacture. We must be at par. To some extent, it was forced upon us because there were these embargoes, but to some extent, it was also very wise policy. Now, in the case of AI, the fundamental technology we are importing, And like Jio is now importing from Google and Facebook. They brought in a lot of money and capital to sell them some equity. So I feel that rather than saying we won, I would say that the equivalent thing would be like if the atomic energy people said, we will invite many foreign people. We will not make our own reactors. We will not do research. We will invite foreign people to come and set up their plants and give us electricity. That while it has short-term value that you can get electricity quickly, but you also become dependent on the technology forever. And you're always one generation behind because they're not going to give you the latest. And so when they're giving you generation N, they're already working on N plus one and N plus two. So in the case of Jio bringing in foreign artificial intelligence and digital people and big data people and all that, is being celebrated in India as a sign of great progress because, you know, we are now number two or number three in the world for a market of Google and market of, you know, Twitter and Facebook. But I think rather than celebrating that we are consumers of foreign technology, we should be producers. We should be producers of technology, our own technology. And so I want to discuss this with you that just because there was no embargo in AI, bringing in AI and digital technology, while there was embargo in the case of atomic energy and space, and so we were forced to indigenize. Do you feel that it has been a strategic error that India did not invest in its own AI? Now, in the case of China, they have Jack Ma, who is the Chinese big billionaire. He started very humble, but he decided that he'd take on the Google and the Facebook and the Twitter and the Amazon. And so he has built some very big industries. China has many people like Jack, with Alibaba, Tencent, Baidu, Huawei, all kind of companies. So India doesn't have those kind of very giant companies in AI. Do you think that somewhere India lost track of the strategic importance of research? While after independence, when India was very poor, we invested in atomic energy. Homi Bhabha was very clear on that. And we invested in Satish Dhawan and various others, big pioneers in ISRO. But we never did something like that for AI. Would you care to comment on this problem?
Well, this is a very important issue. For example, when I entered atomic energy in the year 1964, now, at that time, atomic energy went through a lot of embargoes and restrictions and technology denial and whatnot. But there was nothing of that kind at that time. But I remember Dr. Bhabha had enunciated this principle of self-reliance. But while he did that decide and we constructed the first power plant imported from US, also decided to set up a domestic uranium power, uranium production, open uranium mines in the country. And in spite of the best of exploration efforts, the grade of ore in Indian mines was found to be very poor, something like 0.06%. Now at that grade and those days, nobody would touch it because that was the grade of reject material and not an ore body. So it was, you know, any economic assessment done at that time would have kind of driven to a conclusion that this is not viable. But Dr. Bhabha, he opened that mine. So on one side, he imported a nuclear reactor for which, of course, the fuel also was to come from abroad. Other side, he's opened a mine which is under Indian circumstances also was known to be non-viable. But that is non-viable in terms of when you compare it in the context of uranium price, international uranium price. He knew that uranium is not going to be traded so easily at some stage, certainly not for India. And he also knew that the cost of uranium doesn't make much difference to the unit energy cost because it's a very small fraction of the total cost of production of electricity. So he went ahead and we made a commercial success of Haywater reactor technology. So all I'm trying to say is that the concept of self-reliance has to be seen in a holistic manner. Now, coming back to artificial intelligence, one could think of starting a very aggressive activity in terms of education and research in artificial intelligence. One could also engage in developments of some technology step by step and take it to higher level. At the same time, accelerate that process of learning by engaging with others. So we can collaborate with other countries and do some projects, see what it means to apply that. And there are not just technology dimension, there are also other, as you yourself have brought out, socio-political, economic, all dimensions are there. So we need to see that. So now, unfortunately, if you just take a look that, no, I just sign a contract and everything will be available very cheap. And frankly, being the biggest customer is not to be proud of.
Yeah, it is something. I'm so glad you're saying that. I am so glad.
It is something which the vendors, foreign countries,
you should be happy.
They will be very happy about. But for us, our aim should be we should be the biggest vendors, not biggest buyers.
I go to all these conferences where the limelight is given to speaker after speaker who stands up and says, we are the third largest in mobile penetration. We are the fourth largest or second largest in internet. We are this much largest in how many WhatsApp users we got. I mean, and I tell them that you are making your vendor proud. You are making the producers of those things proud that you are such a happy customer, such a large customer. It's not a matter of pride. It's just that we have a large population. And so if we have a large population, obviously we'll buy the maximum number of shoes, the maximum number of clothes, the maximum amount of drinking water, the maximum amount of milk. And similarly, the maximum amount of technology, technical things, which are commodities. There's nothing to be proud of that. So to be proud, you should say we are exporting so much. We're the second, third largest producer in R&D, and it is our operating system. It is not Apple or Windows or Android. It is our operating system. It is our apps are the biggest apps in the market. If you were to say that in computer technology and artificial intelligence, Indian minds have made in India products which are the best, then I would be very happy. But that's not the case. One difference between atomic energy and AI is also that in AI, Indian brains are among the best all over the world, but they are not working for India. They are either working in the United States, or if they're working in India, they're working for Google India, Microsoft India, foreign vendors. The intellectual property belongs to them. We are providing the brains and we are making their intellectual property. But I think in atomic energy and space, in both those examples, India produced scientists who worked in India for India, because those institutions backed by the government produced so much benefit for society, for economics, for political. It had, these are not just technocrat issues. These space and atomic energy is an issue for every economist and every social scientist. They have to think about it. Now, AI deserves that place, but hasn't received that place. So what has happened is in the last 15 years, AI, the Indian brains, all went somewhere else because there is nothing like that of that scale in India. So this is because I think the Homi Bhabha didn't exist for AI. Homi Bhabha, as you just mentioned, was brilliant in saying we have a short-term need and a long-term need. Short-term need we'll fill by bringing in from foreign countries whatever we need. We will bring it in and we will then do reverse engineering. We learn from it. But we'll also plant seeds for long-term R&D ourselves. And then in the end, the long-term R&D will catch up where we'll have our own technology also. China did that. China in artificial intelligence 20 years ago said that by 2025, they want to be number one in artificial intelligence and catch up with or beat the United States. And it looks like they're doing that. So this is why the United States is worried, because there are military applications. There are so many kinds of applications. China, whether they were doing beg, borrow, or steal, whatever their method of was, they did some lot of. They are filing a lot of patents, more than USA in artificial intelligence. They have more artificial intelligence engineers represented in international conferences than any other country, and they also stole a lot or licensed or whatever they did. But they managed in 20 years to, starting from nowhere, they now become like number one. So they did short term because they also sold cheap labor, cheap factory labor to make money. They sold cheap manufacturing to the American factories and said, come and do your manufacturing here. They did short term, but they also did long term. That is the Bhabha vision. Now, in India, there was no Homi Bhabha for artificial intelligence. This is a very sad thing. One brain could have done so much.
Well, you are absolutely right. And so let me expand that even further. For example, artificial intelligence, of course, one is algorithms, but you need to train those systems on a lot of data.
Yes.
Now, where does the largest data reside? And I'll put it to you, India is the place.
Of course it is.
Now, so of course, the at the initial stages for smaller systems and all, you can train and prepare, develop those systems even where large data, because large data may not be required. But going forward, particularly when you're talking about addressing issues society-wide or country-wide or such major things, you need to validate that on a very large data. Now, so all I'm trying to say is, while we should certainly focus on R&D and artificial intelligence and progressively upgrade ourselves to be comparable with the best in the world, but at the same time, we should recognize that data is going to be our strength. And we should not allow that data to go away cheap. And we can leverage that, our ability to host that data, to in fact develop collaborations which have larger benefit for us, even in our R&D or the development of algorithms and things of that kind. So I think the way to do, in my mind, is that you must develop collaborative efforts, which of course can be done in respect of any other technology development. But here we must do it in a manner that we actually start applying them as we qualify these AI systems, start applying them to larger and larger domains. And that would require validation against a larger and larger data. So we have that important control on data, and that can be leveraged to derive larger benefit out of collaboration.
For a long time, I've been saying that India should not become a digital colony by exporting its data, but India continues to export its data free. I'm saying that every time you do a Google search, you are supplying big data to Google. Every time, yes, you do Google, as far as society is concerned, they are hacking your brain and they are saying, Dr. Kakodkar's interests are these. And when you give the results, this is what he clicks, this is what he doesn't click. They are figuring out your psychology. They're figuring out the psychology of hundreds of millions of Indians every single moment in real time. Every post you put up on social media, it is ranked, it is rated in terms of your profile. And every post that they send to you, whether you like it or not, affects your profile.
But the problem is bigger than that. For example, let us say you have a system which is validated by some society or some community, which is not similar to the society or community that we have here. Then you kind of transpose that technology onto this alien or different society. I think there is no guarantee that even if you have developed a tool which is fair in the society where it was qualified, that it will remain fair in a new domain where the characteristics of the society are different.
On the issue of bias in artificial intelligence, because even within a society, even within America, the Black Lives Matter movement is saying that the AI is prejudiced against them. So when AI is used to figure out who's qualified for a job, they're taking thousands of job applicants and figuring out whom to invite for an interview. Certain minority groups are saying that it biased against them because the AI system is trained on people who are not from the minority community. So gender, there's gender bias, there's LGBTQ bias, there is minority bias. There are all kinds of biases. Now, the point is that in the United States itself, there are these voices speaking against the very big companies that own all the AI. But I see that in India, that kind of a voice does not exist because the social scientists and the NGOs that ought to be informed about all this are not informed. They're not educated. So that is what my book is trying to do, is trying to inform them, give them a seat at the table, give them a voice. So they should come and talk about how this big data controlled by the big companies at the top is not representative of the Indian public. And so the issues are huge.
You know, as you said in the beginning, during the opening remarks, now the answer to this question is that we must carry on our own domestic R&D, and we must have a strategy that the gap between the best in the world and us is minimized, or in fact better still is made in our favor. In the sense, we should be better. You know, AI is going to change the nature of jobs.
Of course. Completely. Yes.
And when that happens, the question is, one thing is a much more amount of work will be done by technology. So, first of all, the low-level jobs will vanish, but even high-level jobs, you'll be able to do in a much shorter time. So, we'll have a lot of leisure, quite possible. Now, the question is whether human beings will spend that leisure in further evolving themselves for good, or the devil in the man will become more powerful.
So I fully relate to this, but my perspective is a little different. I think that this AI forecast that we'll have a lot of leisure time, and the question is how to spend it, applies to rich countries. Because they can afford a lot of unemployed people. Maybe they can support them. But if in India, to be competitive with the world, and AI comes in, and 1.3 billion people, most of them will not have jobs, as you yourself said. Either they will have no jobs, or they'll be underemployed, or there'll be artificial job creation just to keep them employed, which means they're a burden on society. And you could imagine several hundred million people in India being considered a liability, being considered an economic and social burden. So the question is not that they are going to sit at home and wear these AR goggles and leisure time, and they're going to enjoy life, and they'll have robots doing all this work for them. The point is they will have no buying power. If they don't have buying power because they're not producers, they're not productive producers in an economy. Their value for wages is not there, because machines have taken over their wages. And since they don't offer anything productive, useful in economic terms, they have no buying power. And if they have no buying power, society is not going to give them the luxury of sitting at home and enjoying leisure time and having a good life. So that vision of AI producing leisure time is a vision that has come from the West. But for poor countries, developing countries with a large population, I think the bigger worry is not that we'll have so much leisure time, we won't know what to do with. I think the bigger problem is that we won't be able to feed the mouths. We won't be able to give them jobs. And so rather than talking about too much leisure time, they'll be unemployed. So what you don't want are people who are unemployed and have leisure time.
Yeah, I fully agree. I fully agree. But this is where Gandhi had problem with technology.
Yes.
You know, even at his time, he didn't want the textiles produced by high manufacturing rate machines in comparison to hand-spun, hand-woven textile, because he was concerned about exactly the same problem. But the same, for example, the charkha, which was a single spindle device in his time, even today, khadi is produced on amber charkha, which has maybe 8 spindles, 16 spindles, 24 spindles, and which is driven by solar power. So, what, if I understood Gandhi right, what You know, many people think he was against technology. He was not against technology in my view, but he was against a technology that becomes exploitative. And as you correctly observed, AI badly implemented will become exploitative. But at the same time, see, that doesn't mean that we shun AI and remain backward, because we are living in an interconnected world. So we must become competent in AI, in my way of looking at things, and make sure that the divide between the rich and the poor, the advanced countries and the not so advanced countries and all, is minimized. And with our demographic dividend that we have, I think we have a great opportunity to do that through education. And if we don't do that, we have to blame ourselves. So after all, if AI can be driven by the bright Indian youth going abroad, why can't AI be driven by the same bright Indian youth doing here? There are larger number available here. So my point is, AI is a great tool. It has arrived. You cannot wish it away. The right thing would be to engage with this technology, be competent in that technology, and as I said, create human beings with benign mind. And so rather than, allow the devil's mind to take over and leverage AI, I think Indians should show that benign minds can leverage AI and do a great good to the humanity. And that is the way to go. That's what I was saying.
These are good words of inspiration. And any final comments or advice on my book, I would welcome your thoughts.
No, I think it's a great book. Certainly those battlegrounds which you have defined, they are actually a lot of food for thought for several stakeholders in the society. And I do hope that a lot of debate gets triggered as a result of this book, which will be good for the society and the humanity at large. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's been an honor and a privilege to talk to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.